Good morning. We're glad to see everybody's smiling faces here this morning. Looks like we're a little shy of the 86 members, but we've got at least 20, so we can rock and roll. I'm going to ask Representative Mike Glanton, if he will, to do an invocation for us. Mike.
Thank you. Good morning. Would you pray with me? Most holy and gracious God, we just come before you this morning just thanking you for being the great I am, for the grace and the mercy that you provide to us each and every day. And Father, we pray for the families of the members of this committee. We pray for the leadership of this committee and for this great state. And we ask that you would be with us in all the decisions we make for the residents and citizens of this great state. We ask these things and all things in the mighty and unmatched name of Jesus Christ. And those in agreement said, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Representative. I will turn the meeting over to the Vice Chair of the full committee, and we'll present a bill.
I think I can. Yeah. Okay, Mr. Chairman, your mic should be on. We're ready when you are.
All righty. Good morning, everybody, again. I hope you all doing well, and hope you all enjoy this 7:30 start time. I mean, I thought everybody would really enjoy it. It helps with traffic and helps getting in the building, and I'm sure everybody enjoys that. And no, in all seriousness, thank y'all for making the attempt to be here this early. As y'all know, we've got a lot to walk through, and we've got to present to rules at 9 o'clock. So just want to make sure we got plenty of time to get through the bill and then be ready and out of the way of the rules chairman when he gets ready to present or gets ready to have his meeting here in a little bit. So as you flip through your tracking sheets, you will see some changes in a House of Representatives and the Joint Offices of General Assembly. There are statewide changes dealing with 2% adjustments and retirement. And I will not hit on those within the document unless there's something that's notable. So we will go forward into actual changes that we made on the House side other than those statewide adjustments. So Section 4, Audits and Accounts, line 4.1.6, a transfer of four positions in auditing over to the Department of Community Health. I would like to thank everyone that is on, and all of you are on subcommittees, and I want to thank y'all for the work you've done there. It may not seem like it sometimes in those subcommittees that you feel like maybe that it really matters, but I want to tell you it does, because I rely on what comes out of the subcommittees an awful lot as we go to work to compile the budget and try to balance. And so when it comes down to trying to balance and figuring out if we've got to take some funds from somewhere to get into balance, we weigh heavily what the discussion was in each of the subcommittees. So I just wanted to say that real quick. Going on to Section 5, Court of Appeals, 5.1.15 and .16, two adjustments there, one for internet billing, and the other one is raising the staff attorneys there that work for those justices up to the L4. It'd been quite a while since they'd seen any adjustment, so we're making kind of a merit adjustment there as well. Under Judicial Council, 6.3.4, a true up on the new judge orientation number, and then at 6.3.5, those positions, they really didn't have a defined goal or objective for those positions, so the committee felt at this point those were not needed. 6.4.5, dealing with state court judge retirement, we needed to catch up on that for a couple of years, and so that's what we're doing there. 6.4.8, again, the adjustment for internet billing. 6.5.4 under JQC. It is a position and funds related to the reestablishment of the JQC. 7.1.5 under juvenile court judges. Then asked for a director and two coordinator positions. And at this point, the subcommittee felt that two coordinator positions were needed, but the director was not, so we've made that adjustment. 7.2.2 actually provides an increase in the grant amount going to counties that have juvenile courts. The increase will be $15,000 per circuit there, so it'll raise that grant to $100,000. Moving on to prosecuting attorneys, 8.2.8, they was an ask there for 15 additional assistant DAs. The committee at this point felt that it was more important this year to match the number of juvenile ADAs and APDs, the public defenders. So you'll see that over in another section here in a few minutes where that is balanced out. Let's see, moving on to somebody had asked me yesterday too, and I just wanted to say real quick, 8.3.5 dealing with the prosecution of elder abuse, that line there at 144.362 is another position to try those elder abuse cases. Section 9 Superior Courts, 9.1.5, again, the internet billing. You'll see several other adjustments that are dealing with statewide spreads. 9.3.7. They'd asked for 10 law clerk positions. We're saying we'll do four. Then the addition of the new judgeship for the Northeastern Circuit, moving the start date to January 1st, 2018, is to July 1st of this year. Supreme Court, Section 10, 10.1.6. Committee felt at this point they didn't need the procurement coordinator, that we will look at that later. Then moving on down to 10.1.7, they'd ask also for one senior accountant position. They have two on staff now, and just we felt that it wasn't necessary at this point. If you look at 10.1.9, we've got an adjustment. It was fully funded for the entire year, but what is in the base there was not considered, so we've made an adjustment for that. 10.1.11. Again, dealing with those law clerks, and in 10.1.12, an adjustment we had made in travel in the amended budget. We're reflecting it here in the full year budget. No changes in state accounting office. No changes in DOAS. Section 13, Department of Ag. 13.2.6, you'll see 11 positions there. Most all of those deal with food safety. We do have one structural pest inspector and one plant protection inspector that are included in that 11. So you actually got 9 going toward food safety and 2 that deal with the other things that affect each of us. As our state continues to grow, Commissioner needs more folks out there doing work to protect all of our consumers. Under 13.7, Soil and Water Conservation Commission, many of you, I am certain, have gotten emails and phone calls from your district supervisors. And as I've said, I served as a district supervisor for about 6 or 7 years before I came to this house, so I understand what the commission does. Pardon me for a second. If anyone can cure sinuses, I'd be glad to talk to you. The move here at 13.7.6 is moving 8 regional coordinating positions over to Cooperative Extension. In that move, those individuals will become employees of the Cooperative Extension Service. However, they will continue to do exactly what they have been doing for the Soil and Water Conservation Commission, only under the auspices of the Cooperative Extension Service. There are 3 offices that will be closing. However, those individuals will be moving into cooperative extension offices either in the county they're at or an adjoining county, or if that for whatever reason does not work, if there's a technical college or university nearby, we will find space there for them. They will also be set out in a sub-program under Cooperative Extension, so we'll always have those positions out there where we can keep track of them to make sure that they're still out in the state and they've not been absorbed into doing other tasks. It also allows them full and complete access to any of the information the Cooperative Extension Service has, which a lot of their work, those of you from Southwest Georgia that are familiar with the Stripling Irrigation Research Center, know there's an awful lot of work Cooperative Extension does on ag irrigation down there. So these individuals will have unfettered access to that as well. 13.7.7, for whatever reason, we're not quite sure. There had been annual funds for a vehicle purchase within the Conservation Commission. We typically bond those unless, in, like we did in the amended budget where we needed to catch up, we do it with cash one time. So we've taken those one-time funds out, and as they need vehicles in the future, we will then bond those. Moving on, banking and finance, no changes. Behavioral health, 15.1.5, you'll see a reduction for a one-time add last year. 15.2.13, another one-time add that we took the reduction. 15.2.14, Georgia Options is a community organization that helps individuals that have severely mentally handicapped individuals in their homes that they're taking care of. Helps those folks go out and continue in their careers while someone helps them look after that individual. Due to some of the changes under FLSA, they were coming up considerably short, so we're helping update them for that change. Moving on over to 15.7.5. We made a one-time add for help with the juvenile code rewrite last year, so we're capturing that one-time add there. 15.12.1. IPSE grants, the Inclusive Post-Secondary Education Grants, have been quite successful. However, we wanted Katie and her subcommittee, Chair Lady Dempsey and her subcommittee, felt like that they wanted to help this organization, and so we had included an ad there, but after further research realized that we could move these grants over to Voc Rehab where they will receive the 4-to-1 federal match. So you'll see the grant money actually moving over to Voc Rehab. The money that remains here is actually that for the coordinating position. So the money that's being spent there greatly gets amplified and creates many, many, many more scholarships than what we've had in the past there. Section 16, Community Affairs, 16.2.4. We had put in $100,000 last year for the Coastal Regional Commission for the for some coastal infrastructure. The governor had captured the one-time funds, the $100,000. We've put $50,000 of that back. Moving on to 16.3.7, many of you have spoken to me about the Georgia Advocacy Office and the way the fundings had changed or disappeared for those. Are we on the same page? Same verse. 16.3.6. My bad. Anyway, you'll see a move at 16.9.1, taking that item out of special housing initiatives and moving it to departmental administration to allow those advocacy offices to remain open. So moving on to 16.9.1, you'll see where that transfer is made. And at 16.9.2, you'll see a slight reduction because one of the five offices has closed, so we're just capturing that savings there. 16.10.4, dealing with Second Harvest in South Georgia. We had put some additional funds in last year into their base to do a study for all of the food pantries and food distribution centers around the state. We'd initially taken that out, but however, when the storms coming through, we felt like that $25,000 can actually make a big difference in the work that they're doing down there this year, so we'll look at it again next year. 16.10.5, some one-time funds we'd put in for the Central State Hospital Redevelopment Authority, just capturing what those one-time funds were. 16.11.4, small film production grants that we put in last year. We were not able to implement the way that we had intended to, so we're taking those out. 16.12.1 and 12.2, the governor had recommended eliminating the funds to Georgia Rural Water Association and the RCNDs around the state. We have restored those cuts. However, we did take a cut at 16.12.3 for a planning contract with the ARC, Atlanta Regional Commission. Moving on to DCH, Section 17. Several adjustments that are just basically moving within the agency. First of those is at 17.1.6, and you will see a corresponding reduction over at 17.7.12. And that deals with the mandatory nursing home audits. As we know, we've gotten a little bit behind on that, so DCH had asked for some help getting it in the correct program so they can get caught up. 17.4.6 and 17.4.7, you'll see a cut and then an add back. We always do the one-time adds for the FQHCs. We had established a new one in Jackson County and Jenkins County last year, so we're taking the one-time funds out there. However, we are establishing two FQHCs, one in Cook County and one in Lincoln County. Of course, Cook County is were recently announced at the end of this month they will be closing their ER, so we're trying to help with some primary care there. 17.4.8, Augusta University is working on a rural health support and study program down there to help with placement of not only doctors but PAs and allowing docs to go through surgery rotations in rural Georgia. And they'll also do some coordination between hospitals to help smaller hospitals have working relationships with the larger tertiary centers around the state. 17.5.5, increasing the salaries for the nurse surveyors. You'll see a reduction at 17.7.13 where that money moves from to there. At 17.7.6, you see a small change under total funds, just a recognition of the matching dollars that go with that program. Then at 17.7.14 is a transfer within the agency from 17.8.15 for a 3% inflation adjustment for the nursing home cost report. 17.7.15, a 3% rate increase for the source case management fees, and that comes from 17.8.16. 17.7.17, as we increased the primary care codes last year, we did not realize at that point that if at the point of the increase, if you were a provider, you were in good shape. However, if you became a provider after that point in time, they had not been an opening up of the attestation period there to allow new providers to come into it. So what we're doing there is making a new adjustment for those that attested after 2013 and 2014. There's a corresponding item as well at 17.8.14 that goes to pay for that. 17.8.11, reduction of one-time funds for ADHD cost-saving measures. Then you'll see as well 17.8.12, we've heard from a lot of our dentists that have high Medicaid patient counts. They've not seen a rate increase for quite a while, so we're telling DCH to utilize existing funds to provide for that 5% rate increase, and you'll see it in a couple other places here as well. Moving on, 17.8.13, again, that corresponds with the item above at 17.7.17 on the attestation for the new rates. The 17.8.15 you'll see is the move for the 3% inflation for the nursing home providers. Nursing home cost report, excuse me. So then you'll see another reduction at 17816 dealing with source. You saw the addition above. And then just a reduction at 17817 for reflecting a change in what they're thinking the projected expenditures are. 17.93, again, the dental code, recognizing some federal matching funds there. And then 17.94 goes back again to the attestation piece that I mentioned earlier. Moving on over to physicians workforce, 17.12.11. Small adjustment there, only 9,726 slots are filled, so we've captured a savings there. Telling them to use some existing funds for the Family Medicine Accelerated Curriculum Training Program at, 17.12.2. That's amazing that this country boy is talking too fast for y'all to keep up. I'm sorry. Kind of like Ron being the preacher yesterday. I've never heard anybody talk that fast. He preached three sermons in that 5 minutes he was up there. He had 30 minutes on a Sunday morning. Ain't no telling what happened. So anyway, 17.12.2. My bad, I'm sorry. Telling them to use some existing funds for a program that's going on down there at Memorial in Savannah. Then you'll look at 17.12.3. Of course, Georgia, we are capped out on many of our residency slots. So a lot of these hospitals that are doing residency programs and universities doing residency programs, they're providing these new slots above the cap. So what we're trying to do is help reimburse them for that cost, because we as General Assembly and the governor have made it a priority to find or to make available more residency slots in this state. Also at 17.12.4, this will be a one-time add to start up the behavioral health program at Memorial in Savannah as well. 17.14.1, you'll see a reduction there, but it corresponds to an add undergraduate medical education at 17.6.1, so it's just a shift within the program or within DCH from one program to the other. It was actually asked for by Morehouse School of Medicine. Then 17.15.1, reduction there. That was the gap year for the Southwest Georgia training program. They're up and rolling, so it's not needed any longer. 17.15.2 is adding more positions for the loan repayment program that we started last year as well. 17.18.4 under drugs and narcotics. In the pay raise package, the 20% pay raise package, there are 9 agents that are also pharmacists that work there. They're post-certified, but they had been skipped over. And so what we're doing is doing the 20% raise for those individuals there. Under Section 18.2.8, the Gwinnett Day Reporting Center will be starting up. However, again, one of the oversights that we all make mistakes, and that's fine. That's why we work together as a team to help each other. And it was just that those individuals had been missed in the 20% as well. So we were glad to help correct that. Moving on to Department of Corrections, Section 19. You'll see some movement here as DJJ's medical work will be transferring over to the Department of Corrections through the Memorandum of Agreement or the contract with Augusta University. So you'll see those ads at 19.5.17 and 19.5.18. You'll see the corresponding reductions over in DJJ at 31.36 and 31.47. With that combination, there should be considerable savings. So at 19.520, you'll see a reduction of $750,000 there to capture those savings. Moving over to the Department of Defense. As we are all aware, we're going into another round of BRAC. And part of our job is to do what we can as a state to make sure that Georgia is positioned in the best possible light to protect our military installations here in the state. And Chairman Earhart had brought this program to us at 20.1.5 of establishing a military family support center, which is basically a commissary up in the Marietta area to help the military families in our state. About 400,000 authorized users per year in the state that will be able to take advantage of that. No changes in Section 21 driver services. Under decal 22.1.5, recognition of other funds there, which would be lottery funds. They're also matched with some federal funds from DHS, so just a recognition of those other funds in that line item. Economic development 23.1.5, a slight reduction in travel. We replaced about 80% of that agency's vehicle fleet, and Chair Lady Houston felt that there was an ability to capture some savings by replacing the older fleet. Moving down to 23.3.4, the Council for the Arts had asked for an additional position. However, the subcommittee had found they have five positions there already to administer only about $1.2 million in grant funds, so that was not necessary. 23.3.5, a reduction in operating efficiencies there as well. 23.3.6, that line moves down to 23.4.1. We're basically breaking the grant program out from the administrative program there under the Council for the Arts, making sure that there's a clean separation. Over to 23.9.7. You'll see several reductions at 9.7, 9.8, 9.9, and 9.10. These were one-time funds. At 9.10, however, that money was put in for the help market the year of the film. This now is the year of the music, and so we've taken a reduction of $200,000, which leaves $600,000 in existing funds there to be used for marketing of the year of the film. Section 24. Education. At 24.1.1 and 24.1.3, just recognizing the 2% merit increase and the adjustment in teacher retirement and a lot of this deals with extended day, extended year teachers. You're going to see a similar add under career and technical, but it also in ag ed, you've got district ag ed teachers that go around to help in classroom teachers as well, and they often get overlooked, so we're making sure that they're covered under the 2%. 24.1.6, we've had numerous requests for young farmer programs. Newton and Fannin counties are both ready to go, so we're adding two young farmer programs there, and then an adjustment for increased admin costs at 24.1.7. Under 24.4.6, non-QBE grants are moving funding there to non-QBE grants. You'll see that ad come back here in just a second. Many of you have commented under 24.4.7 about PBIS, or Positive Behavioral Intervention Support Systems. We've made a couple of ads, and you'll see another one here in just a few minutes, dealing with PBIS, and this will be two additional PBIS trainers to work around the state. Small increase at 24.6.1 for communities and schools. Then moving to 24.12.4, an adjustment for the residential treatment facilities. Later information showed us that the reduction in student count was not going to be as deep as was originally thought, so we've made that adjustment. And then 24.12.5 comes from 24.4.6, 125,000 I mentioned a few minutes ago. Going on to QBE program 24.17, at 17.3.4.5 and 0.6, those are all true ups in the calculation with later information as we get closer into the school year. Then as you go down to 24.17.7, Again, recognition of a true-up there under the Special Needs Scholarship, another true-up under Charter System Grants, then an increase in funding for school counselors. In 2012, the State Education Finance Study Commission had recommended one counselor per 450 students. We're not going to get to that ratio, but we're trying to get closer to it. And out of the Military Affairs Working Group, you'll see 24-17-10, helping the school systems that have military installations nearby with some additional counselors to deal with those kids that are coming in that have been moving around the country, so they need some additional counseling help there. Then 24-17-11, just asking DOE to get us an update on what the state school bus fleet looks like right now, age, mileage, and similar information. Going on down to 24.22, at 22.1 and 22.3, again, recognition of the 2% merit increases. 24.23.6, recognition of savings, where we'd eliminated 8 of the Georgia milestone tests last year. With that elimination, there's savings, and they will be renegotiating the contract with Data Recognition Corp as well. Then at 24.23.7, you'll see that move over to GOSA, and it deals with AP STEM testing, and we'll be providing one AP STEM test for every student in Georgia's school system going forward, should you agree. No changes in ERS, no changes in forestry. In the Office of the Governor, you will see a few adjustments at 27.9. At 27.9.7, you will see the add for the AP STEM tests. And then language at 27.9.8, instructing them to use some additional existing funds for innovation grants for our lowest performing schools. 27.9.9 is using some local funds as grants to local systems to increase participation in AP STEM courses. As those of y'all and us in rural areas know, that a lot of our students, when they're trying to get in our major universities here in the state, if they do not have above a 4.0 grade point average, which is impossible without taking an AP course, it's almost impossible for them to get into those institutions. So we're just trying to make sure that those programs are available and those opportunities are available for Georgia students. Under Human Services, 28.6.9, our CASA folks, as we all know, do an incredible job across the state and helping to protect over 19,000 young people that are in our foster care program statewide. During 2016, they saw about a 13.5% increase in those that are served. So we've made an addition of 500,000 there for the things that they're doing. 28.6.10 kind of goes hand in hand with our folks at CASA, dealing with especially assistant attorney generals or our SAGs. We made a small increase last year on their hourly rate. We're coming back and increasing that hourly rate again this year by $5 per hour. So that takes them up into the high 50s per hour. Many of you have probably run into the same situation I have. Our areas, it's very hard to find someone that will do those cases, so we're trying to make it a little more attractive for those individuals to be willing to do that. 28.8.10. Emory University and Dr. Levy at Emory are working on a Georgia Alzheimer's project. They're calling it the GAP project. Their initial ask was a little over $4 million. We're going about halfway on that initial ask, and what it's going to deal with is early detection and early treatment of individuals with early onset Alzheimer's or dementia. Many of you that have been touched by this, as I have, know that the earlier, the sooner the diagnosis is made, the better the outcome potentially is for not only the individual, but for the family as well. So we've been working with them for about 6 months on that project. Moving on to 28.15, dealing with out-of-home care and DFACS. While there's a lot of work in this budget for law enforcement, there's a lot of work in this budget for education. There's an awful lot of work in this budget for our DFACS families and foster families as well. And you'll see a lot of that right here in these items. And what the committee has worked to do is to try to push the dollars down to the foster parents themselves, whether it be relative foster care, DFACS foster families, or foster families working for CPAs or working with child placing agencies, trying to get the money down to those families for the daily cost of taking care of these kids. So we've made several adjustments throughout the program, but at 2815-4 and 2815-5, we're saying we're doing a first year of two installments to raise their per diem by $10. So we're raising it by $5 this year, and we will come back and attempt to do the same again next year as well. 2821-1, Family Connections. Back before the recession, or back during the recession, the county allocations had been cut significantly. We're just raising them back to where they were before the cuts, to $50,000 per county program. 2826.1, the Roosevelt Warm Springs Hospital. As many of you know, Augusta University has taken over the operations there, and they're doing a wonderful job. And we're thankful for them and thankful for them doing this. And as they're rolling into that program, they're working toward a self-sustaining model. So we're recognizing part of that savings here this year, and we'll probably look again at it next year as well. 2827-5, I mentioned the IPSE scholarships a while ago, the Inclusive Post-Secondary Education Scholarships, moving it from the other program where we saw it earlier over here, then qualifies it for the 4-to-1 match. And so in doing so, it draws down total funds of about $2.5 million, which will provide 766 scholarships instead of the current number they're doing today. No changes in insurance, GBI. See some statewide spreads there, some adjustments. Going down though, I want to draw your attention to 30.3.6. Last year, Representative Scott Holcomb led our House, I think, in unanimous passage of the rape kit bill. GBI has had numerous kits brought to them for testing, so they do have a backlog. So under 30.3.6, we're adding 4 scientists and 2 technical positions to help address that backlog, and it should help them get through the cases much quicker. At 30.3.7 and 0.8, we're just annualizing some positions that were added last year. They were partially funded in the amended 17, so we're picking the annualization up of those there. At 30.4.6, again, one-time funds, we've eliminated those one-time funds there and then broke them apart as well for transparency in the 2 items I mentioned above that. An adjustment at 30.6.2, the merit funds, we just needed to move them to a different program there. So under juvenile justice, section 31, you'll see at 31.3.6, that is part of the transfer over to the Department of Corrections I mentioned earlier. So that's recognition of that there. And then at 31.4.7, the other move that went over to the Department of Corrections as well. Department of Labor, no changes. Department of Law, section 33. You'll see an increase in funds there for a paralegal and an admin position. With, of course, increased caseload as we grow as a state, there are more cases that we're involved in, so they were needing some additional help there. 33.1.6, the fellowship program that was established last year is still in effect, but we're waiting to see the results of it, so we decided at this time we'll hold off on adding to that for now. Moving on over to DNR, one small adjustment at 34.5.6. Dealing with state historic sites, it'll be an addition of 1 position and then some salary adjustments for the other historians there. Of course, those individuals work with DOT and other agencies as they work on projects due to our historic preservation efforts that we value in our state as well. Pardons and paroles, no changes. State Properties Commission, no changes. Under Public Defenders, Section 37.1.5, recognition of some increased costs for training that is required for the public defenders, funding that training. And then a training director at 37.1.6. You'll see a reduction at 37.2.6. Those courts are not up and running yet, so we've taken a deduction there. Said no to a phase-in of a three-year project on electronic case files, just not at this time. Then you'll see at 37.2.8, something that Chairman Welch and his committee have worked on for several years, trying to get parity on the salary scale for public defenders with the prosecuting attorneys. We've made a good step there at this time. 37.2.9, recognizing the new judgeship being created in the Northeastern Circuit. And then at 37.2.10, increasing funds for 10 additional juvenile public defenders. So it puts us on parity with the prosecuting attorneys and public defenders now. So there'll be 25 of each across the state. 37.211, annualization of 15 positions that were partially funded in 17, and the same in 2.12 there as well. Under public health, our friends at Emory have been busy, and they're working to address the needs of several special populations across our state. 38.1.6 is another program that they're starting to work on helping adults as they transition, adult autism patients as they transition into being adults. So teenagers transitioning out of teenager care, moving into adults and trying to function as adults. So they've got a very innovative program that they're working on, and we think that it would be good for all Georgians as well. 38.4.5, our regional coordinating hospitals, and this was one I, after 7 years of doing this job, I was not aware of, but we have regional coordinating hospitals across the state that in times of emergency, they're the ones that are called on to kind of coordinate the care for victims within an area that has been stricken through tornadoes, ice storms, whatever kind of weather event we may have. And so they're seeing a loss of some federal funds, and so what we're trying to do is back them up with state funds for the loss that they've seen in federal funds. 38.10.6, you'll see an addition of 15 environmental health specialists. Again, as the state is beginning to grow again, there are more septic tanks being put in, more restaurants being opened. These individuals are the ones that go around and do that inspection work to keep all of us safe. Department of Public Safety, looking at down at 39.6, at 39.6.5, under the Firefighter Standards and Training Council. They've asked for several years for some help there. And this year we're able to do that. They've asked for two compliance and evaluation officers to help cover the state. So we're making that addition. We're also adding two vehicles for that as well, and the computers and related equipment for those positions as well at 6.6 and 6.7. Under post, you'll see at 39.8.9, you've probably gotten a phone call from your local police chief. Many of our smaller towns find it very hard to be able to pay for the police chiefs to go to some of their annual required training. So we're making an adjustment upwards to help pay for that annual training there at 39.8.9. You'll see one adjustment at 39.8.6. If you look at it quick, you're not going to see it in the numbers, but the 189,393 in the governor's budget changes to 189,363 in ours, just a true up. Moving on to the PSC, Section 40. 40.1.5, just as we have membership as members of this body, and NCSL and Council of State Governments and SLC. So does Public Service Commission have a national group called the National Regulatory Research Institute that the PSC uses quite a bit for research that they're doing on a nationwide basis. So we're adjusting the amount. They've not been paying their full dues for quite a while, since 2010 actually. So we're trying to help them get to full payment of their dues there. At 40.3.5, you'll see the addition of a new utility analyst for renewable energy. As we see solar farms popping up across the state and other things going on, it is becoming a bigger job for them to keep up with some of that, so we're helping them there. Section 41, Board of Regents. You'll see some adjustments under Ag Experiment at 41.1.6 and also 41.3.7. Ag Experiment Stations and Cooperative Extension through the buildings, they, of all the institutions across the state under Regents, Ag Experiment owns more buildings than the rest of Regents combined across the state and various different things that they do. They've not seen an adjustment in the M&O in over 10 years, and I think it actually goes back probably closer to 20, but they've not seen an adjustment. Many of these are older buildings. They don't need to be new buildings. The older buildings are working just fine, but it does cost more to operate those newer buildings, or older buildings, excuse me. 41.3.5, you'll see the transfer of the positions from soil and water over to cooperative extension that I mentioned earlier. 41.5.5, under forestry cooperative extension, looking to hire a network administrator for the Center on Invasive Species. As you know, the woody adelgid and several other things are attacking many of our forests in North Georgia, and they are working diligently to try to figure out a way to stop, as we call it at home, that little critter. 41.12.5 under Marine Resources. Last year, they lost federal funding for the oyster hatchery manager position and an aquaculture agent. So the committee felt that we needed to continue to grow that, again, helping grow Georgia jobs and Georgia industry. Public libraries, just a small adjustment. There had been a reduction for the self-insurance fund, and it was not needed there. 41.15.5, again, those of us in rural areas know that Georgia Youth Science and Technology Center provides training for many of our STEM instructors across the state, and so we've slowly been increasing funding for them over the last several years, and we're doing another small increase this year. 41.18.12, many of you saw the press release yesterday. We'd established what we call VECTOR, the Veterans Education Career Transition Resource Center, last year under Regents. And after it's gotten up and operating, we feel that it's better suited to be under TCSG, and that move is being made. You will see that addition over under TCSG when we get there in just a few minutes. Under VET Med, 41.19.5. and 14.19.6, the addition of some folks there dealing with food animal positions and with poultry research as well. Georgia Military College at 41.21.6, updating the state share of their annual maintenance costs there. Of course, GMC is kind of a one-off in our state. It is one of our military college institutions. However, they do high school and college. And so it's kind of been a struggle over the last several years to try to update their funding to take care of their students, and that's what we're attempting to do there as well. Under the Department of Revenue, Section 42, Revenue Processing, 42.8.5. In the amended budget, we'd taken a reduction there, and we're just annualizing that reduction in this budget. Moving over to Secretary of State. Again, we had taken a reduction under corporations at 43.1.1 in the amended FY17 budget, and we're annualizing a further reduction there as well in that program area. Student finance. My stack, one stack's getting thin and one stack's getting thick, so it's making it hard to get through. At 44.15.1, you'll see an addition of $100,000 there under the service counselable loans. Those are loans that our National Guard has been able to use very successfully as a recruiting tool to get individuals to go into the National Guard and then and go forward and help with their education as well. 44.16.1, the governor had proposed going to, on the tuition equalization grants, had proposed going to $1,000 per year. We're just saying let's look at 950 this year and then we'll address it again next year. No changes in teacher retirement. Under TCSG Technical College, section 46, you'll see the move there at 46.4.7 of the Vector Center moving over there. Section 47, the Department of Transportation, you will see there are no changes in their document from the governor's rec, but you see the difference that House Bill 170 is making. If you haven't been driving up and down the roads and seeing the orange cones and barrels, then I don't want to ride with you because you obviously have a vision problem. But you know, I remember during the 70s and 80s, if you came to Atlanta, you always ran into road construction then. And we're going to start seeing that happen again now that we've got a sustainable funding model for DOT to use. No changes under veteran services. No changes in workers' comp. And then I will let you look and enjoy Section 50, which is bonds. Some will be happy. Some will be disappointed. I hope no one is mad. Mr. Chairman, I'll be glad to take some questions. I hope I've explained it well enough, but we can do questions.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You do have a number of questions. 80. Representative Petrie, do you have a question? Representative Elam? Number 80.
If you pushed your button, that's Brockway.
Brockway?
I accidentally bumped the button, sorry.
Oh, sorry.
Well, so much for George Gwinnett College.
Chairman Pruitt? No?
His budget document's laying on his button, so.
Chairman Green? Oh. Representative Fleming? No?
Is the floor mic button on?
Floor mic's on.
Okay. Just shout it out.
Mr. Chairman, on page 9.7, 8.2.8, that's what you talked about, I believe, prosecutor, attorney's counsel, and making some money on doing this. And I was trying to understand what we did on page 9. I think it was 8.2.8, you said. Exactly.
That money goes over to the juvenile public defenders, so it will actually equal them out statewide. I think it's 25 and 25 ADAs, the prosecutors and the defenders. It just equals those. We've been working for several years trying to get them at parity with each other, and so we've used these funds to do that with for now. Trying to get all the public defenders up to parity with those that are prosecuting, and so we've got several places throughout the budget that we still have some work to be done. And if you raise one or increase the number of one and you're not on the other, it just throws us that much further out. So we're just redirecting these funds to try to equalize those under juvenile defenders and prosecutors.
I was thinking back when we started that program, I thought we did committed that 100%, 90%.
Well, and it may have been that, but it has gotten skewed well beyond that split. Chairman Welch can explain it in great detail. Yeah. Chairman Welch, during the vehicle replacements that we're doing in, and I'm telling on you, in the amended FY17 budget, and it tickles me because that's how hard our subcommittee chairs work to keep our agencies telling us everything and they need to be telling us, actually was asking for VIN numbers on vehicles that were to be replaced. So he's pretty thorough.
Okay, Chairman Parsons.
Thank you, Chairman Carson. Chairman, I wanted to ask you about line 43.5 under Public Service Commission. I had, when the governor's recommendations first came out, I had, of course, gone through, but I had specifically noticed that there were no recommendations from the governor for the Public Service Commission.
Give me the line number
it
again.
It is 40.3.5.
40.3. Gotcha. Okay.
And what they've done, PSC has created a new section, energy efficiency and renewable energy is what they call it. So they've created this section, and then they've asked, and I know they've asked for several positions over the last couple of years, but they've asked for a new position to fill a position for a new section that they created. And I'm just wondering on that. I would really question that, but I was just wondering what kind of compelling story that they gave to fill that position.
Well, as you said, they had several additional requests. This wound up being their number one priority. Chair Lady Houston had listened to it. Actually, her subcommittee had added an additional position that was their number two priority. And as we were trying to get balanced with the budget, we have to go in and trim some things from time to time. Is my understanding, though, as we continue to build the solar farms, as I mentioned a while ago, across the state, that is becoming a bigger issue for them to deal with. And as I further understand, and I would ask you to maybe also follow up with Chair Lady Houston, that the folks they currently have on hand are not necessarily specialists or experts in the area of renewables, and so that's what they're trying to find someone that is.
Right. Well, I would just say by now they should be experts on it.
Well,
but thank you.
Okay.
Okay, Chairman, one more. Representative Peak.
Hello, Chairman England.
Yes.
Real quick, on page 43, line 24.17.7 on the special needs scholarship. You and I chatted about this the other day, but could you just clarify why? Is there just a decrease in the utilization of that special needs scholarship? Is that, are we just not seeing the use of that?
Partly, but then we always, in the amended budget, do the true up. So if there are more students, there's no way to predict the number of students that are actually going to be using it, because just like K-12 education, you've got a number of students that transfer out because of age. You've got a different number that are transferring in. So every year that number's up and down. And so we always try to true that up actually in the amended budget.
So it's not just an underutilization of the program at this time. Okay. All
right. No, you'll see ebbs and flows from one year to the next on the number of students using it. But it's not an underutilization. It's out there. It's being used. We just usually true it up in the amended.
Okay, thank you very much.
I think one more, Representative Labricchia.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Chairman England, this is not specific to this budget, but just a kind of a general question. This is my first opportunity to be involved in this appropriations process, and I've heard some conversations around about how our agencies have the ability or voluntarily do zero-based audits or zero-based budgeting. Do we get reports on that, or how can you give us an update on
what
they do?
Actually, we require it in law. Some agencies do it every year internally, but we do under law that this body passed several years ago. Every agency in state government over a period of 8 years shall participate in zero-based budgeting at least one time. Every year they do. We're running way ahead of, I think we're on year six or seven. So, but even with that, we're way ahead of what would be the split over 8 years. And we do get a report every year of those that have been ZBB'd that year. Many of the changes you see in here are after OPB gets those reports. Many of those changes are moves within programs or within agencies from program to program, and those are the result of the findings of zero-based budgeting. And it is posted on OPB's website as well for you to see, for everybody to see.
I think your public don't realize that you do that.
Well, Mr. Chairman, are there any other questions? I think that's it. Do I hear a second? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. We are adjourned.